Uh-oh. It's on now. Yeah, Az, you always get the job done. I set the request. It's on.
What's up, Joe? We did it.
Andrew. Yo, Andrew Yang. D. Andrew Yang.
Woo!
My brother, let me tell you something. I know nothing about technology. Absolutely nothing. So I'm looking through there trying to request. It's like, it's the hardest thing I ever try to do. But listen,
this is virus, man. This virus is making us do shit that we never had to do.
Andrew, let me tell you something, Andrew. For those of you who don't know, or you've been under a rock or under a moon or a cloud, this is Andrew Yang. Up to last month, you were still running for president.
This is true.
Of the United States. I find you brilliant. I find you authentic. I find you as real as they come. Super duper smart. I would say that much. And so smart, I had to take certain little notes. I want to let my people get to know you. I wish you would have done this before you started your campaign, because my people, they the real ones. Now, where you grew up at, Andrew?
I was born in a town called Schenectady, New York.
No Schenectady.
Yeah, and then my folks moved down to a town called Somers, closer to the city, when my dad took a new job. So Westchester County, essentially, with Schenectady thrown in there for the first number of years.
You know, what are your, like, musical influences? It doesn't have to be hip-hop. What kind of music? What's your thing?
I partied to your music for quite a long time there, man. You know, we would go down to the the bars in Alphabet City. They'd be playing your shit. I think my wife and I might have danced to your music back.
Oh, you definitely danced to What's Love and all that, you know?
Yeah, for sure. But you know, I'll tell you, I grew up in the '80s, so I listened to like new wave, that stuff, and then some alternative. They didn't call alternative then. And then when hip hop came out, I listened to a ton of hip hop too. At first, it was Public Enemy and that generation. And then
it's so crazy. You know, it's so crazy because I got Van Jones over here the other day, and he was talking about Public Enemy. Like, you know, I mean, they were radical. They were militants, and with a message. And everyone loved their message, whether they were African American, Asian, white, whatever it was. They were speaking so truth that everyone fell in love with them.
Yeah, I was like the angry, angsty Asian kid in the suburbs. So pretty much like anything that was pissed off, like I was good with.
Yo, Andrew, let's go there, Andrew. You being Asian American, right? How do you feel about Donald Trump calling this the Chinese virus?
You know, it's painful because people have been getting spit on and assaulted and beaten up and all sorts of really nasty stuff around the country. And a lot of people feel like Trump kind of gave permission to blame the virus on Chinese Americans, Asian Americans. And it's so unnecessary. Like, he doesn't have to do that. And at first, I tried to ignore it because I was like, this is just trying to distract us from the real issues. Which that he, you know, stumbled in the early response to the virus. But then now that people are having their way of life changed in you know, fundamental ways, like going to the grocery store and feeling like they're not welcome in their own neighborhood, their own country, you know, it's more serious than even I'd known initially. I have a friend who's the CEO of something called the Crisis Text Line, which is when you text if you're depressed or considering some kind of self-harm. And the percentage of Asians that have been using Crisis Text Line went up from 5% of everyone to 12% of everyone, which is much higher than our percentage of the population.
You know what's sad? When this started, I think back to 9/11, and I have a lot of Muslims friends. DJ Khaled's my brother. He's the first person I call on 9/11. And I was like, yo, stay in the house. Do you have a gun? Like, because I knew there was going to be hate crimes. And anybody who's performing these type of crimes on Asian people, obviously these are hate crimes. These are bigger than just I'm gonna beat up the Asian guy because there's a virus out here. This is a hate crime.
Yeah, it's tough. And, you know, like, I understand that people are being devastated by this virus. And it's really easy just to want to try and find someone to blame it on, really. You know, and the fact is Asian Americans are suffering in the same way anyone else is suffering. And the last thing, the last thing we have anything to do with, frankly, is the fact that this virus is here wrecking lives. So I understand the human reaction, but it's terrible. You know, it's really destructive to Asian Americans around the country. And I've been getting messages that have been heartbreaking, honestly, Joe. It's
I think it's
the first time for many Asian Americans to feel like we're in the spotlight in this way, in such a negative way.
Man, it's sad. You know, unfortunately, America has a deep-rooted racist policy. And from slavery up to fighting for civil rights just to vote, so many civil fights out there. And the Asians, you know, unfortunately, it's like their turn, right?
My friend Ronnie Cheng called it the merry-go-round of hate. That it's like the Asians turn down.
We gotta find somebody to hate. Like, it's sad, but America is like this. And all the Asian people I ever met in my life were positive, beautiful people, smart people, intelligent. And I never met a bad one, to be honest with you. And it's unfortunate that that's happening in America. You know, when I look at you on a in the debate stage, and obviously your demeanor, your calmness, and you're just incredibly intelligent. I asked myself too. This is before it hit here. I said, "Is Middle America ready to see an Asian American be president of the United States of America?" You know, like a female president, you know, Hillary should have won that. You know what I'm saying? They had a whole bunch of other obstacles going on, but she didn't win. And I used to watch interviews of men just saying, "I would never vote for a woman for president of the United States," and all that ignorant shit. And the same thing with you being Asian American. Did you think you had a chance, Andrew?
You know what? I was brand new, and I still got 5% of Iowans to vote for me. And we had internal numbers showing that there were a lot of people that had me very, very high up as their second choice.
I think if you were growing, if you was on a little bit longer, because for some reason I just felt you getting stronger and stronger just before, you know. I'm not trying to give you false hope. I'm telling you the truth. I just seen you getting stronger and stronger. And what you were saying was very relative to what was going on with, I just don't understand why America is so diverse, and yet we seem to not be able to believe that somebody of any other color other than a white Joe Biden, a Bernie Sanders can actually be elected. You know, Obama was elected, and that was like a miracle, and we didn't believe it. But I mean, like, it's just not reflective of America. You know, if you went out yourself in the car and drove around America, you would see Asians, you would see Black people, you would see Spanish people, you would see white people, you would see Muslims, you would see Jews.
Yeah, the real world is fast and furious, right? it's much more like that. Yeah, I'm with you. And I will say, Joe, like, I genuinely did not feel like my being Asian American was going to hold me back in the race. And that could be me just being very positive. But I think people were very, very anxious about this race, particularly trying to find someone they thought could beat Donald Trump. And when you're in that boat, I think many people really veered towards the familiar. And Joe and Bernie feel very, very familiar.
You know, I'm a big Joe Biden fan. I've always been. I think Joe, he's a little slower now. He got, I mean, let's just keep it real. I'm a little older now. My bones hurt a little bit more from performing, you know, and Joe been around a long time. And, but I, you know, he's a little slower than he's been. I'm behind Joe 1,000,000%. And I hope he handles himself. One thing I know, he's not a punk. So he's not going to let Trump punk him and talk all that craziness and debates. Joe come right back swinging with that. Bernie, I think you, Bernie, I think Kamala, I think Edwards. I mean, I've never heard in any debates or any presidential election systemic racism talked about, or prison reform the way it did, or the dream is that, like, you guys brought so much light to these things that now people have to talk about that going for president, and I commend you guys for that.
Yeah, it was a great field, and I got to know and become friends with just about everyone that was on the debate stage with me. You know, and we talked about things that had not been talked about before, but the key thing is we're not going to be able to get any of this stuff done unless we get Trump out of there in the fall. And it's going to be a really tough fall campaign. I mean, there are a lot of variables right now. To me, the big variable was the economy before the coronavirus, and now the economy is obviously tanking. But there's a natural response among many Americans to kind of rally around your president when there's a crisis. So ordinarily, when there's a crisis, the president's approval rating goes up, and Trump's approval rating has gone up slightly, not the way, you know, like that earlier president saw their approval rise, probably for obvious reasons, because a lot of people are like, hey, I'm indoors because someone screwed up. And, you know, and it was this administration that was... So it's going to be a tough match in the fall. Let's put it that way. Like, Trump has some advantages. He has some real disadvantages. If to get any of the stuff done that we want to get done around...
What do you think is Trump's weak spot? What do you think is Trump's weak spot? Like, if you went and you was nominated to go against him, what do you think is Trump's flaw? Like, where would you get him? If you had him on the ropes, where would you say, I could finish this guy and become president?
I think his weakness is that he needs to be the center of attention all the time. And to defeat him, what you have to do is you have to ridicule him, minimize him, make him seem ridiculous, and that you're going to go focus on the real problems and get the work done. I got many, many thousands of Trump supporters excited about my campaign because I was like, look, you're legitimately pissed off because we blasted away your manufacturing jobs or your farming jobs, your retail jobs, or what have you, and we need to do something about it. My solution is put money in your hands, but I'm not going to villainize or demonize you for it because, you know, like, I'd be pissed off too. And that worked pretty well with a lot of people. Like, if you just bypass Trump, then you can win over a lot of Trump voters. That to me is his weakness, because when you start trying to respond to every Trump provocation, then he wins and you lose.
Yeah, he's the 50 cent of politicians for sure. He's a troller. He's antagonizing. He knows how to divert the issues. He knows, he knows, Trump's something else, man. And, but at the end of the day, I just feel his strong point was the economy, and unfortunately, because of Corona, that's no longer a strong point. You know, I know you're doing something for the people. You created a fund, and tell me about this fund you created for the people who's losing their jobs and stuff like that.
Yeah, we're up to $1.2 million thanks to all of the incredible people that have been supporting humanity forward. But I started a nonprofit to move universal basic income, the other ideas of my campaign forward, even though I'm not running for president. And we're starting with putting $1,000 into the hands of 1,000 families in the Bronx that really need it. I think that's where you grew up.
Yeah, they really need it in the Bronx.
Yeah, and then we're putting another 150,000 or so into the hands of tipped workers that lost their jobs, because everyone who worked in restaurants and whatnot, obviously, is getting hit really hard. And then we're giving another 100, 150,000 or so directly to people who come to us and ask us for it at movehumanityforward.com or in our social media channels. We can't help everyone. We're being overwhelmed, obviously, by the need.
We got some guys on here that want to. They want to know where to go ask for this money, Andrew.
I understand. I mean, we're trying to help, but it's at movehumanityforward.com. We're giving micro grants of $250 to $500, so it's small amounts of money, but that could make a big difference trying to get someone groceries or get through this.
Man, that's a month of groceries, brother. That's a month of groceries. I mean, let me tell you something, man. What the one thing this thing has done has made me so grateful and so thankful for every moment I have ever shared. I start thinking about friends of mine that passed away 20 years ago, and God gave me 20 more years to enjoy my life, whether good or bad, ups or downs, just the fact that I'm here. And it's made you just take a moment, sit down, appreciate your family, appreciate life, everything you've been through. And even me, I'm looking up at the sky, not so many planes. The sky looks happy. My brother Noriega, the rapper, he lives on the beach. He's like, yo, the water's so clear. So as far as global warming, I think everybody sitting down and not moving is actually blessing the earth in a weird way, you know? And this coronavirus, man, you know, New York City, man, is really hurting my people in New York. I know at least 20 people in New York City that has coronavirus. I know about 3 people that passed away. I know one that's critically in the two that's critically in the hospital. And this thing is just like, it's just going, Andrew. It's just going. And I just see it like it goes eeny, meeny, miny, mo. So for the most part, everybody just gets a terrible flu, but then it touches that one person and says, you come with me.
Yeah, it's dark, man. It's like a wildfire ripping through communities. You don't know who it's going to affect most dramatically and critically until it's too late. And so the only thing we can do is try and protect everyone, you know, like self-quarantine, minimize contact, social distance. You know, we're doing this from home, obviously. It's a really, really tough time in New York in particular. The numbers I've seen around New York are devastating. And so if you are in New York City and you're watching this and you have an opportunity to go someplace that may be less hard hit, you should take that opportunity.
Yeah, but Andrew, you know, a lot of people left New York and came to Florida and they brought the thing with them.
Yeah, you should leave New York City and then self-quarantine for 2 weeks.
Leave New York and self-quarantine because they brought it down here.
Yeah, it's real. Like, you know, I mean, the spread is, and this is the thing that makes me angry about our government's response, is that we need tests. You know, it's like if you went someplace else and then you can get tested and then know what's up in an hour or so, then there's no fear of you carrying it with you when you come from New York, you know, and that's something that we should be able to provide. Like other countries have the drive-throughs and the rest of it. Like, we need to get there. So this is something.
I look at it, Andrew, I look at it crazy, and I say to myself, we knew it was in China for 2 months, close to 3 months before it came here. We have satellites that can look up people's asses, right? So this couldn't be a surprise that tons of people were dying in China and that this was a crisis. And we had an opportunity to get the protective. I mean, I see pictures of nurses with plastic bags tied around them and glasses for their, like, it's like, this is the United States.
This is the United States, man. And you're right. So the Chinese government did try and contain information to suppress global awareness of this crisis early on. But despite that, we still did know with enough time to be able
brother,
to
brother, I watch movies down. Just like you. If we could figure out who Kim Jong-un's mistress is, we know that people are dying in China. Like, there's no way to say people weren't dying in China and you knew it was an epidemic and you should have prepared for it.
Yeah, we still had notice, you know, and there were other countries that jumped on it to a much higher degree more quickly, and they suffered less for it.
Yeah, and in the long run, and I wish nobody harm, not Donald Trump, even though I don't agree with his, with Donald Trump, but I don't wish him no ill will. That is a fact, right? But I'm worried about the Trump supporters who he's playing it down to them like it ain't no big deal. We'll be back in Easter. And for that whole first 2 weeks when this thing was just growing out of proportion, he was like, oh, it's a Democratic hoax. I'm worried about them. I live in Florida where it's really a Republican state, whether Latino or white, these guys are all Republican. And they're walking around like there's not a problem. And guess what? There is a problem. And this does not discriminate. If no. Prince Charles could get it, this does not discriminate. In the UK, it's going to tear them up.
Yeah, you've hit on what to me is the central problem, which is that if we don't have enough people acting to try and diminish the spread, then this thing could be with us for months, over a year. You know, the vaccine is probably not going to be broadly available until, let's call it 18 months from now. And so if we don't get this under control, and we just have waves of it for the next year and a half, it's going to be even worse. Like, there's nothing we can do but try and contain, control this virus and get it under wraps to a point where we can revive the economy. But if you try and revive the economy too early, you just end up with a relapse. It's almost like a person where they're like getting over something and they just be like, oh, I can do it. It's like, no, you just need to freaking wait until you're well. Like, we need to wait until we get this virus under control before we try and revive the economy. And even if you did try and revive the economy, the reality is, you know, it's like NBA games are still canceled. Concerts are probably still not happening for a while. People aren't exactly going to be running around, you know, at 100%. Even if Trump does say, hey, you can go outside again.
Yeah, my thing is, when you say a vaccine, I'm not talking about the time, 18 months. What would this vaccine be? Like the flu shot we get at CVS or Walgreens? What would the vaccine look like?
Ideally, it would be very, very similar to the flu shot that we get. And it may even become something like the flu shot where we get it annually.
So, and then we would be protected from this thing for life. So you're saying we're going through a temporary zone, being that we don't have an answer for the coronavirus. And in time, maybe a year and a half, or in a year, we'll get a vaccine where everybody knows when it goes into winter, take the COVID-19 shot. That's what we're looking to do?
Yeah, eventually we'll have a vaccine, and then we'll be able to immunize enough of the population where this will not be devastating our communities in this way.
You know, you got a lot of conspiracy people. I've seen so much conspiracies you can't even believe. And they won't stop sending it to me. And some people saying, you know, the vaccine's going to kill people. It has the coronavirus. It has it. Like, I've heard so much stuff, Andrew, that so you're saying when the vaccine's available, it will help the people?
Yes. When the vaccine's available, it will immunize the vast majority of us to the coronavirus, and it will get this under control. But the truth is, we all know we can't wait 18 months like this. Like, you know, I mean, we have to try to take the brunt of this spread off the table early on, and also give our hospitals time to respond and build up capacity. Because any time that we buy the healthcare system to build up hospital bed supply, ventilators, protective gear for nurses and doctors, it's going to save lives, not just of coronavirus patients, but also the other patients who need medical attention during this time. Like, if you have a heart attack or a stroke or like any of a number of things and you go to the hospital and there are no beds, you know, that's a problem for you too. So
listen, so Andrew,
the time we buy is literally going to save lives.
We've been fooled. We've been watching a lot of Rocky movies. We've been watching war movies in America where America just storms through countries and everybody cheers for us. And we know that that's not true in Afghanistan. We've been fighting them for 20 years and ain't nobody cheering for us. And we've been really, really arrogant as Americans, thinking that we're better than everyone else. And that's part of the problem with everybody still being in the streets, still walking around, thinking that somehow, because we're American, some Rocky vaccine is going to come out of nowhere and it's going to save everybody. And that ain't true. It's going to take time for it to come.
American exceptionalism does not work on a virus, if that's what you mean. You know, like you said, this thing doesn't discriminate.
I don't like being in house arrest. I don't like it.
Yeah.
I don't like it, but we got to do what we got to do. I hope this don't go a year in the house. That's crazy. You know, because a lot of people lost their jobs already. A lot of people don't know how they're going to pay their rent.
Yes.
How they going to pay their mortgage.
We should be putting much more cash into Americans' hands than the current bill is doing. We should not be testing based upon your tax returns last year. We should just give it to everyone. And we shouldn't care if you paid taxes last year. That's the one that upset me the most, because I have a lot of friends who, you know, didn't make enough to pay taxes and whatnot, but they need money more than anybody. So I'm upset that our response is not broader and frankly, more consistent, because the fact is, like, you put $1,200 into someone's hands, they're going to need that money again in what, 4 weeks, 5 weeks, like whatever it is. So the fact is, Congress is going to be back trying to come up with another stimulus package days from now, honestly. You know, it's like this is such a stopgap. But, you know,
I heard my people telling me the whole Bronx is in the street. The whole Bronx is going to die. They all going to be sick. If they're in the streets, y'all, listen, I'm not saying this for no reason. My people, listen, if the cats is in front of your building, you need to go downstairs and argue with these guys. Because if they don't go inside, they're going to give it to their grandmother, grandfathers, and get everybody sick. And this younger generation, and I never want to sound like the old head that's mad or whatever, but, you know, they are kids, and they need to be respectful. They need to know that they're hurting people by transferring this. And last week, we had a spring break in Miami. I guess Miami, they make all their money off of tourism. They knew that wasn't supposed to. Hundreds of thousands of kids in the middle of the beach. It wasn't supposed to happen. And yet, they let it happen. Y'all got to start talking to these young kids out there and let them all know, yo, like, why are y'all so disrespectful? Oh, you think you're invincible, you can live forever, but you're giving it to older people and they're dying, people in your families? Like, it's mad disrespectful, man. You know, that's just terrible, man. Like, you know what I mean? What did you teach your kids? If you can't tell your son or your daughter to stay in the house, like, what kind of parent are you? You know? And you got to understand, this ain't just a flu. This is respiratory. This is pneumonia. This is your lungs drown. This ain't no regular flu, bro. Don't listen to nobody lying to you that this is a hoax or anything like that. We lost Andrew. God bless Andrew. Great guy. Pristine, you know, Pristine Jewelers on the check-in, Nori on the check-in, Hovey Baby on the check-in. This is crazy. And the fact that we keep yelling at all the kids in the hood, yo, get inside, they don't want to get inside. Like, you know, I got my head bust open a million times by cops. This is before Instagram, before there was social media. They would bust your head open. A lot of these kids going to get their head bust open because people are realizing that, yo, this is real. People are dying. And these kids ain't taking it serious. Yo, Avi, you might as well get on with me if you want to do a conspiracy about Russia had the vaccine 2 years ago. Russia knew what it was. You know, I can't stand up here and tell everybody every I seen a preacher earlier talking about God told them this and this and that. I believe in God too much. Actually, I prayed to God for like an hour straight on my roof today for everybody, for you guys, for everybody. But when the preacher started telling me that God told them to tell us that this, I you know, I don't know, man. And that's all I'm saying to you. So if you look at these numbers and you see Elmhurst Hospital, 13 people died yesterday in one hospital. You realize the numbers is real and it's swallowing up New York. And if New York don't listen, look, Rikers Island. Rikers Island is running rapid with the coronavirus. They can't go nowhere. They're in jail. So you got COs, you got inmates, and it's going all around America. And I'm going to tell you about this virus that's going on here. This virus, if you ever notice, if you into politics, if you ever looked at presidential politics, the biggest argument they always have forever is Social Security or Medicare, meaning money, taxpayer money, for the old people who already paved the way for us, right? So to take care of them old people. Now there's a virus that kills the old people. No more problem, Social Security, Medicare, because this thing is killing everybody. Then what's the next one? If you work and you got diabetes and you always out because you're sick, or you fighting cancer, you sick, you got high blood pressure, you costing your boss more money, or you can't even go to work. And so you got Medicaid. So that's another bill. Now this virus is killing them people. Now we go into the jail where they can't leave. Whoever's vulnerable there are passed there. Homeless, forget it. Homeless, forget it. It's gonna wipe the homeless out. And this is sad, bro, because this is all God's people. This is all, you know, people we love, you know, and if you're a young kid and you out in the streets and you think it's cute, man, it ain't, you know, and I don't like you and I don't fuck with you. I'm keeping it real. If you think that you don't care about nobody else and you want to be arrogant, don't fuck with Fat Joe, because Fat Joe ain't fucking with you at all. And people out here in Florida, if I go to the supermarket for my essentials and I got my mask on and I got my gloves and I'm strapped, don't be looking at me like I'm crazy, bro. Because I love my life and I love your life. In case if I have it, I don't want to give it to you. Right? Positive energy, everybody. I love, that's Hector Lavoe. That's my idol, one of my idols in Spanish music. He's the greatest. I think Mark Anthony comes in second. That right there is the Wahlbergs. I am Joey Wahlberg. You don't have these guys. You don't have them. Reggie Saunders, you see, I've been making movies with these Jordans. You know how it's going down right here. Listen, God bless you all. I love y'all. I'll see y'all tomorrow, 8:00. The Fat Joe Show. That was real talk with Fat Joe. Let's go.